Do you feel like you have too many interests to be a good specialized engineer? Well, I'm here to tell you that that's a good thing. And there's a whole world of books that can help you turn your scattered interests into an amazing career. Let's get into it. Hey, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Anna and I'm a German mechanical engineer based in Sweden. I've mentioned this in the past, I'm not one of those people who always knew what they wanted to be when they grew up. And even now, I am an engineer and I love being an engineer, but that doesn't mean I want to be an engineer forever. There are so many things that I could see myself do in the future. Sticking to just one profession and becoming really specialized in that field seems quite boring to me, while trying out lots of different roles within and outside of engineering and constantly learning new things seems really exciting. This goes against a lot of popular career advice. You're supposed to specialize in one profession. And even if it's nowadays normal to switch jobs several times throughout our careers, you better make sure that there's a logical thread running through your CV because you don't want to confuse recruiters. This ideal is even more prominent in engineering. The common idea is that you pick a major like mechanical engineering and then you specialize within that major throughout your studies. For example, in production engineering, like I did. And then on the job, you might specialize even more, say in production engineering in the automotive industry, and maybe even in a specific step of the production chain like car body construction or engine design. Even though the reality on the job can be very different, this idea is especially instilled in us engineers because the first people to teach us about engineering are our professors. And university professors, as we all know, are the front runners of hyper-specialization. But there's a new line of thought coming into the picture in the form of research and in the form of books. It's a very refreshing perspective that sees having many interests as a strength. And I have selected my 5 favorite books on the topic, which have helped me understand how to fit all of my interests into my schedule and use them to my advantage. Let's dive into the books. The first book I want to talk about is Refuse to Choose. Use all of your interests, passions, and hobbies to create the life and career of your dreams by Barbara Sher. This book calls people with many interests scanners as opposed to divers because we like to expand our knowledge in breadth rather than depth. The book is split into 2 parts. The first part of the book discusses common problems and concerns you might have as a scanner, like something is wrong with me, time is running out, I have commitment phobia, I'm too busy to do what I love, I won't do anything if I can't do everything, I can't get started, and I can never finish anything. Part 2 of the book is all about the different types of scanners there are. Barbara Sher differentiates between cyclical scanners and sequential scanners. The idea with this is to help you figure out in which way you like to pursue all of your different interests. If you have more or less a fixed set of interests that you like to cycle between, then you're probably a cyclical scanner. And she divides this type of scanner into 3 different subtypes: the double agent, the Sybil, and the plate spinner, which I think is really fun. Or on the other hand, if you like to dive deep into one topic until you've had enough and want to move on to the next one, then you're probably a sequential scanner. And the subtypes of sequential scanners are serial specialists, serial masters, jack of all trades, wanderer, sampler, and the high speed indecisive. And for each of these types, the book shares a story of a real person that is that scanner type, and it also recommends helpful tools you can use and a life design model that you can follow that works best for your type. And finally, the book closes with a bunch of ideas for jobs that tend to work well for scanners. Now, the second book I want to talk about is called The Episodic Career: How to Thrive at Work in the Age of Disruption by Farai Shadeya. Now, this book doesn't come from the perspective that we have a bunch of interests that we want to try to implement into our careers. It comes more from the perspective that careers nowadays aren't going to be as straightforward as they used to be, and that we have to adapt to changing markets and stay flexible in our careers. So basically, we're gonna have an episodic career no matter what, and this book looks at how to make the most of it. The book starts with a few chapters about today's work situation and what that means for the future of our careers. This part of the book is heavily research-based, and it's a very interesting look at the economy. And then there's a quiz to help you understand which type of work-life archetype you are. Who doesn't love a quiz? And there's 4 dimensions in which you can determine your type. So the first one is, are you cautious or risk-taking? Then, do you care about having a high social impact, or do you basically just care that your job doesn't actively harm anyone? Third dimension is, are you happiest as an innovator or as an executor? And finally, are you mainly a solo decision maker or a team-oriented decision maker? For example, I am an RHIS. A risk-taker who cares about having a high social impact is happiest as an innovator and who tends to make solo decisions. Then the book describes each of the archetypes, gives it a fun name, and explains their their unique career path and challenges and professions they tend to be good in. And the book closes with a couple of chapters on how to use this knowledge about yourself and about the economy to build a successful episodic career. The third book I want to talk about is called Range: How Generalists Triumph in a Specialized World by David Epstein. This book is also not coming from the perspective of trying to incorporate a bunch of interests into your life. It's more a reaction to the ideal of the child prodigy, the notion that the earlier we start specializing, the better we're gonna do in our specialized fields. It's basically evaluating in which context specialists have an advantage over generalists and vice versa. The book is heavily research-based and it features a lot of studies and a lot of examples from the world of sports and music. The book argues that specializing early only really gives you an advantage in stable disciplines like chess, golf, or classical music, where the conditions don't really change over time. So here it's true, the earlier you start and the more you practice, the better you become. But in other disciplines where you constantly need to adapt to changing conditions, like tennis or rock climbing, this isn't the case. Here you need a range of different experiences to be able to react to these changes. And experiences from a lot of different disciplines can often make you more adaptable and therefore give you an advantage here. The book also discusses the importance of something called a sampling period, a period where you try out many different disciplines before you settle on one that fits you well, rather than just choosing something at random early on and just sticking with it. This increases the chance that you like what you pick, that you're going to stick with it, and that you're going to become good at it. Then the book also talks about how breakthrough discoveries and innovations are more likely to be made by teams where individual people have expertise from two or more different fields. And importantly, this doesn't mean having experts from several different fields. This means having individual people that just in themselves have a variety of experience. And scientists who receive the Nobel Prize are also way more likely to have creative hobbies like painting or music, dancing or writing compared to the general population and compared to average scientists. I absolutely love this book. It clearly shows the value of having experience in more than one field, even if the fields are completely unrelated. This means that we don't need to worry about being a jack of all trades, master of none, because there's place for both generalists and specialists in the world. The fourth book I want to talk about is called The Renaissance Soul: How to Make Your Passion Your Life by Margaret Lobenstein. This book calls people with many interests Renaissance souls or Renaissance people based on the fact that during the Renaissance time, people were expected to be educated in a bunch of different subjects like natural sciences, philosophy, athletics, and arts, rather than specialize in just one field. And the book lists five signs that you might be a Renaissance soul. The first one is that you're able to be excited by many things at once, often accompanied by difficulty choosing. The second sign is a love of new challenges. And this also means that once a challenge is mastered, you're easily bored. The third sign is that you have a fear of being trapped in the same career or activity for life. Sign number four is a pattern of quick, sometimes unsatisfying flings with many hobbies. And the final sign that you're a Renaissance soul is that you have a successful career, but it has left you bored or restless. Or in other words, once you become good at something, it bores you. You want to do something else. And the book also then has a more in-depth quiz of 20 different questions to figure out if you're a Renaissance soul. Now, I especially loved all of the exercises in the book. So throughout the whole book, there's a bunch of exercises to help you kind of get to know yourself, understand what you want, and set priorities. For example, you're asked to choose 5 values from a list of values that are most important to you right now. The values I chose were creativity, personal growth, meaning, freedom, and home. And you're also asked to list all of your interests and possible projects that you could be doing right now, and then choose 3 to 5 focal points that you want to prioritize right now. So the idea is that instead of doing everything at once, you focus on around 4 projects or focal points, and then after some time, you can switch some of them or all of them for new interests, new focal points. And my focal points at the moment are developing as an engineer, running my YouTube channel, building a Discord community for engineers and engineering students, and learning how to code. And then the book has a bunch more exercises I haven't all done yet, but I definitely want to. And the last part of the book is dedicated to different career options for the Renaissance soul. There's 5 different options explained in the book. The first option is to pursue different career paths in sequence. So you would pursue one career path for a while, and then once you've had enough, you would give up that career path and start over in a new career. The second option is to have an umbrella profession. So this is basically a profession that can unite many of your interests. The third option is called 2-for-1. So these are basically 2 jobs that you can pursue at the same time. Option number 4 is the so-called JOB, which is paid work that serves your interests in some way. And the final option is a career path with improved life design that can accommodate many interests. And reading through all of these different options and examples of how people are actually doing these was really inspiring, and it gave me a lot of ideas for how I can have a more diverse and interesting career. Now, the final book I want to talk about is How to Be Everything, a guide for those who still don't know what they want to be when they grow up by Emily Wernick. Now, this book was by far the lightest read of them all. It's only about 200 pages and is written in a very entertaining style. Maybe the best part of the book is all of the footnotes, which are hilarious. There's footnotes like duh, or true story, or just kidding. Now, this book calls people with many interests or many talents multi-potentialites, which I kind of like that word, although my favorite word is probably polymath, which is another word to describe the same thing. And this book is divided into three parts. The first part of the book talks about what it means to be a multi-potentialite and what you need to be happy if you are one. And the second part talks about four work models for multi-potentialites. This is quite similar to the Renaissance Soul, where there's also different career options explained, but the names of these careers are arguably better and a little bit easier to understand. So the first option is the group hug approach. So this means that you combine all of your interests into one group hug, into one job, kind of like the umbrella profession from the other book. The second approach is the slash approach. So here you would be doing several jobs at once, for example, as an engineer slash writer slash consultant or something like that. The third option is the Einstein approach. So here you take a job that isn't very challenging and basically allows you to save your energy so you can use it during your free time for all of your interests. And it's called the Einstein approach because this is something that Einstein was actually doing. And the final approach is called the Phoenix approach. Here you follow one career until it dies and then you're reborn like a phoenix into a new career. So this one would be similar to the sequential career from Renaissance Soul. And then the third and last part of the book is dedicated to common stumbling blocks of multi-potentialites and how you can build a productivity system and gain confidence and overcome your fears. So, what now? Do you think you could be a scanner or episodic careerist or generalist or Renaissance Soul or multi-potentialite or polymath? If you think that could be the case, then I recommend starting with one of these books. The first step is recognizing the value in your many interests. Once you've accepted that this is you and that this is good, then you can really thrive. For example, for me, one really impactful step was that I started this YouTube channel where I'm able to combine filmmaking and writing and coaching and business and content marketing with engineering. It gives me a way to build a completely different skill set from the one I'm using in my engineering job and to get really creative. It's probably the best thing I ever did. And it's only possible because I don't see it as a waste of time or as a distraction from my career. I see it as a valuable addition, something that can open up new career opportunities and as a necessary way of balancing out my engineering job with something more flexible and more creative. So, what can you do to bring your neglected interest into your life? I'll leave you to think about this. Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it, and I hope to see you in my next video. Bye. Let's dive into the books.